lot of stories told, but a lot of them weren't true. Probably most of them weren't true, the stories that are told, books, things you watch, everything. And I thank God that that story is true. So men can find fault with it, they can reject it or accept it, but bottom line is, what's going to happen? Praise the Lord. Well, God bless you all today. Feel the presence of the Lord this morning.
Yeah.
It's just a wonderful place to be. And we are glad that you are here. You pray for us today. Appreciate it a whole lot. 14th chapter of Job, I'm going to read to you. 10th verse, one verse this morning. And I guess it's up behind me, so I don't have to give you too much time to look it up. Job said these words, and had good reason, I guess. Said, but man dies, wasteth away. Yea, man giveth up the ghost. And where is he? That's a great question, you know. Never a day goes by that I don't think where I'm going to be when I leave this world. Now, one man, Methuselah, lived in the Bible longer than anybody else, but he died. There's 6.9 billion people upon the face of the earth, approximately, near the account. And one thing that we all have in common with each other, that if Jesus tarries another 150 years, we're all going to die. But that doesn't matter, because we know that for a fact. But the fact is, where are we going to be when we give up the ghost? When Jesus hung on the cross and gave up the ghost, he said it is finished. What did he mean that it was finished? He meant the plan of salvation, the plan of God that was laid from the foundation of the world had been finished, that you and I might taste of a physical death, but we would never have the taste of a spiritual death. Now, there's not probably anybody in here this morning that's a Christian. But what, before you got saved, this thought entered your mind, where would I be if I died? And when you got to thinking about that, it's something stirred your heart. Because that'll cause you to begin to take an inventory. But we've got millions of people upon the face of the earth today, your neighbors and my neighbors and everywhere, it seems like it never crosses their mind that where they're going to be if they die. A rich people on the deathbed will worry about some little trivial thing here on earth. I heard a man the other day, a story where he was passing away, and he was tight, owing money, just loving money. And he just tight as he could be, wouldn't spend anything. Tighter than a bark on the tree, the old saying goes. And so when it come down to the end, they all gathered in the room, he asked his wife, he said, is everybody here? Are my children all here? She said, yes, Henry, they're all here. He said, name them over. Are they here? Yes, Henry, they're all here in the room with you. And he says, they're all here with me in this room. And she said, yes. He said, well, why in the world was the light going on in the kitchen? He was afraid that he was going to waste some money burning that light. Right now, you got it. And they're getting ready to leave this world. And I went to visit a man one time. He was a businessman. And I liked him and everything. But he was already knew that he would not be out of the hospital. I don't know if he knew it or not. But the fella came to see him and worked for him. And he went over and he motioned him over and he bent down to him. And he didn't know what he was going to say to him. But he began to ask him about some tobacco sticks that he's supposed to make. Well, he never, I guess, got to see those tobacco sticks or anything. So there are people in the world who walk through this life and never give a thought, and if they ever did give a thought, they push it out of their mind where we're going to go when we give up the ghost. But folks, I thank God this morning that long years ago, I got to thinking about where would I go if I died. And I was just a young boy. But I knew that if Jesus come back, which I didn't know much about, but one thing I didn't know about, that I could die. I used to go out in the woods as a little boy, and I'd be afraid I'd get snake bit, and I wonder if I'd have time to ask God whatever you're supposed to ask him, because I'm so dumb, I didn't know. But I wondered if I'd have time to tell God that I didn't mean to do all the things that I've done. Because I was afraid that I knew that if I died, I would not go to heaven, but I would be lost. And I was very young in age. And I'd drive down the road in a car sometimes, and I wouldn't be driving. And my friend that I had was kind of a fast driver. And, and a little bit too fast. Sometimes I would be, after the run was over, and after we got back and we settled down, and brought my mind back into my head, instead of having it out there somewhere, I would think, we just barely missed something. We just barely made it around that curve. What if that car had pulled out? One Sunday, one time, four of us was coming in a car. I wasn't driving that fast, but this man lived in a house, and he had a car parked here. Well, my car, when we went by, was next to him. The other two boys passed me, and out there where you turn over to go on 10-13, that guy said he heard that. He jumped up, looked out the window, and he saw four cars all lined up. Two of them in the lane, the other two out. They passed me and went off. I mean, God had his hand, merciful hand, upon us because of what we did. Now, because of his love, and they overlooked our ignorance. But I knew when all of us settled down, that would scare me to death when I think back on that. I think just that close, just that much closer to somebody, and I could be out in eternity without God. But yet, I did nothing about it. I let it push it out of my mind, and I went on. There was another time, this same boy that I'm talking about, I won't mention his name, Vince knows who it is, we were coming back from Salt Lake, and with another friend of mine, which was Clifford Muse, was in the car with us. And also, there was another guy who had a Chevy and this boy had a Dodge. And so they wanted to know which would outdo the other. We were coming back on 60 on US 60 over in Moorhead around there. And the boy was in front of us. My friend got out to the side of him, but with the air coming, he could just get up and they were side by side. One couldn't outdo the other. And all of a sudden we whirled back in behind him. I looked up and saw a great big Greyhound bus. I hadn't seen it, and I looked up and I said, Louisville. It was written across it. But I wouldn't have gone to Louisville. I would have gone out there into eternity without God. Because, and that scared me to death. I'd think about that and I'd shiver because of how stupid we were, but I did nothing about it. But I thank God that one day I got to thinking about it so much I couldn't sleep at night. I got to thinking about it so long that it's not all I thought about it. But I really didn't know what to do about it. But I knew that churches was a place where the people went that was supposed to be going to heaven. So I figured, well, somehow or another, I'm going to have to go to church. If I started going down to a little youth group they had at the Goddard Methodist Church, and a man invited me down, an older fellow invited me down, and I went down and I kind of liked it. So I kept going back. Well, I learned a little bit about it, and I learned more than what I did know, but then pretty soon I forgot about that and went on to other things, and then I was still right where I was to start with. I was thinking about where I was going to be, knowing where I was going to be. I knew enough to know that, but yet I hadn't done anything about it. But then the more I went and the longer I walked, the more the power and the holiness of God began to work upon my heart as a sinner. And one day we were out doing, I don't know what, but we were hitchhiking, me and Glenn Sloan, I and Donnie, out on the road. We went to Blue Bay. Wasn't nothing going on there. So we just turned around and started hitching back the other way. Well, we got picked up by car, to make a long story short, and I ended up in church and used his meal. They were having a revival. And brother, there was a power, there was something I felt in that service that night that I needed to feel that I never felt before. I didn't know what it was. I didn't know how to identify it. But it put the fear of God in me. And more than ever before in my life, I knew I had to do something about it. And I had to find out what to do. And in some way or another, my life had to change. I became one of the most miserable people that you could be around. I could lay down to sleep at night, and always I slept good when I snuggled down in that feather bed. But it got to where I couldn't sleep. I'd get up the next morning, and I'd go back and do the same things I did the day before.